So I'm Robert Steinglass. I'm the immunization senior advisor at JSI, John Snow Incorporated in Washington, D.C. And the session is vaccines, but inevitably we're going to be expanding that discussion to vaccination. The vaccines don't deliver themselves. Once a new vaccine is introduced, it immediately becomes an old vaccine, and their uptake depends upon the functioning of the routine immunization systems. So first, let me introduce the presenters and the discussants. We have two presenters. Dr. Samba So is a faculty member at the Center for Vaccine Development, CVD, in Mali. Dr. Rebecca Gray is the co-director of MSF's Epicenter. We have four discussants: Dr. Fred Were, who's the chairman of the Kenya Pediatric Association; Nina Schwabe, who's the managing director of policy and performance at the Gavi Alliance; Dr. Mark LaForce, director of technical services at Serum Institute in India; and Dr. Paul Herling, who's the professor and chair Novartis Institute for Tropical Diseases at Novartis Pharma. Unfortunately, UNICEF Program Division and Supply Division at NOR WHO were able to be here because they're in a meeting in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. So the general objective is to discuss the need for vaccines that are adapted for resource-poor settings and that are affordable, and also to explore what it takes to develop adapted products for use at scale. Just a few words about some recent progress, although certainly more is needed. The programmatic suitability of vaccines is now a much more serious and formal part of the WHO pre-qualification process for vaccines. There's been a group created called it's called VPAG, Vaccine Presentation and Packaging Advisory Group, which is a safe space for industry and public health practitioners to meet and talk about the desirable products, vaccine products for developing countries. UNICEF, I just learned a few days ago, is considering publishing the average weighted vaccine price to guide countries who are thinking of self-procurement and or pooled procurement, and hopefully this will have a downward pressure on vaccine prices. The pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, PCV, and rotavirus vaccine products have been packaged recently in less bulky formats. And the most promising thing, of course, is that the long delay in getting new vaccines into use in lower-income countries has been dramatically shortened thanks to the efforts of Gavi. So if I can just have the first slide there. In fact, it used to take a long time for discoveries to get put into practice. This just gives you a brief overview of the discovery that lemon juice prevented scurvy 146 years ago, the British Navy replicating the findings. It took, amazingly, another 50 years for the British Navy to adopt the policy, and then another 70 years for the British Merchant Marine. Fortunately, that's not the case with new vaccines. We're getting vaccines introduced very quickly into countries. We're trying to do a lot more in immunization programs. We're trying to reach infants at birth. We're trying to reach adolescent girls. We're trying to reach school-aged kids, unreached populations. We're not just aiming to reach infants any longer. And on top of that, the population in the developing world has doubled in the past 25 years. The system requirements continue to grow. We have more diseases that we can vaccinate against. We have more vaccine doses per child if all of the vaccines are introduced. We have more vaccine volume per fully immunized child by a factor of 4. We have increased costs per child by a factor of 6 if, in fact, all of the vaccines that are recommended by WHO are introduced. And then we have an expanded age group over a life cycle for vaccination. So this is leading to additional stresses on the routine immunization system. This slide just shows that the cold chain that we've had for 30 years is showing its age. On the left, you see 4,100 doses of polio and measles. On the right, 625 doses of rotavirus in the same type of refrigerator. But on the left, the value of that payload is $435, and on the right, it's seven times as much, $4,700. So more volume for the new vaccines is stressing the system. And some of the vaccines, this is an example of disruptive technology we don't actually want to see. This vaccine, rotavirus vaccine, packaged for first world use, simply doesn't fit or didn't fit when it was first introduced into the standard vaccine carriers. Picture of vaccine carriers, and if it doesn't fit and you need more vaccine carriers, where do you put them? And then just a slide showing the imbalance. This is a vaccine in a typical fully loaded refrigerator, and the vaccine itself can cost 25 times as much as the refrigerator itself. And yet there's very little preventive maintenance or timely repair or replacement. So we have an imbalance in the world of immunization. A lot of focus on vaccines, not a lot of focus on the system requirements for their proper storage and protection. We're trying to do a lot more than ever. The routine immunization system is the platform to introduce new vaccines. NUVI is new vaccine introduction. Life cycle vaccination, eradicating polio, measles elimination, tetanus elimination, using this population-based strategy of vaccination to deliver other services. We're trying to do so much, but it all depends upon a functioning routine immunization system that requires support. And it's not getting any support. It's being taken for granted. And as long as children are born, of course, they need to be vaccinated. The focus goes into the high-level things like polio or measles, very little for the routine system. Okay, so with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Samba So for the first presentation. He's going to be presenting on a case study on using Uniject device for giving tetanus toxoid in Mali.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, let me first try to say a big thank you to MSF and DNDi for inviting the Mali group. I'm here with the director of the Mali Routine EPI, Dr. Al-Buhari Touré. So it has been a very good opportunity for both of us to learn what we've heard since yesterday up until now. So we really learned a lot, and thank you very much for having us here. And Mr. Chairman, thank you also for the nice word and for the great introductory talk. I would like to say that we'll try to go a little bit, assuming that we started yesterday with talks from really a lot of big bosses. I can mention Mark LaForce here, who is here, but before him, we hear also over really high-level speech, and we're ending up the bottom. So next time, I would like MSF and DNDi to start from the bottom, from the field, and let then the big chiefs, they make the conclusion, so it will be actually something else. That's a request for me to start. So this experience, I have not participated per se on the field of work. When I was first asked by MSF, Kate, to give this talk, and I said, I don't know what to say, I haven't participated into this. And they said, yes, we got the data, we know what to do. And the chair of the session is actually the designer of this study from Mali. So we learned a lot, and we got data from the routine EPI team. And so we are very happy to share this data with you. And whatever question the team will have, so we here as a team will try to answer together. So I like to show this map before every time I have to talk about Mali, because people, when you say Mali, sometimes they say Mali or Somali or Malawi. So this is our West African French-speaking country, Mali. So it's where Tombuktu used to be, and we hope that Tombuktu will still continue to be part of Mali. So this maternal and child neonatal tetanus is been a big problem in Mali. So we used to organize elimination campaigns, and we have since 1986 when we first started the routine EPI in Mali. So we have really very good, well-functioning routine EPI program. So we also know that we have low coverage, not only for tetanus toxoid vaccine, but for other vaccine in some part of the country. And we also know that this campaign was organized in 2002. And between 2002 and 2005, it was really a very intensive campaign. So we had then this opportunity to be able to use this really device, a single dose used in auto-disable with very fine small needles and individually packed with heat-sensitive vaccine vial monitor indicator on it. So it shows up like this, as you can see. A really nice device. So we then decided with routine EPI partners in collaboration with Basics 2, USAID, and other EPI partners in Mali to implement, to carry out this study and determine if, with main purpose was to see if really we can go very peripheral, very operational, and use what we call in Mali traditional birth attendants, TBAs, so that they can be participating in a very, very peripheral level, very rural, into this to use this device and use it successfully, and also see whether this device will be accepted by the population for vaccinating women against tetanus. So we then selected those traditional birth attendants that we also call community-based vaccinators. Voluntarily, they have to be willing to participate. And the selection was done by district health officers after a selection by the area health officer, who then will be in touch in collaboration with the community leaders and select the potential traditional birth attendants according to three criteria. Community has to accept, the person has to be welcomed by the community, and the person has to be physically ready to do this job, and the person has to be motivated and show personal interest. So we selected only rural sites in Mali, six districts. So I wouldn't mention the name of the districts here. So we use among the six, two districts we use the tetanus, the Unijet device. And then in four districts we use the standard multi-dose vial and syringe needle device. So in 2002, 2004, we then went ahead and increased by adding 20 more districts. Six districts use the Unijet and 14 districts the multivial. And later on, we added 26 more districts for only the standard method. We collected data very simple ways by observation of a traditional community-based vaccinator or traditional birth attendants. And we also observed vaccination sites. And we interviewed them as well, and we interviewed some of their clients selected randomly, and we also interviewed some of the area health officers. We also took into account the tetanus coverage data. These are some of the pictures of the brave traditional birth attendant. These ladies are really champions in these very remote villages. They don't know how to read and write mainly, and We trained them very short, and they were able to actually provide very good results after interviewing 180 sites and also interviewing 346 of them. They were very happy with the device in general. So injection safety was respected, and Unigect was very well received. So the community also accepted, in general, this device. 9 out of 10 users said that they will come back and have, you know, use this device. And the birth attendant, also traditional, were very happy, and the health, the area health officers said that it will be nice for them to have a traditional birth attendant use this so that they can have more time to do something else. And so if we took few other items, increased coverage was observed, mobilize the population and reduce the dropout, just because we reduce immunization workload for the area health workers, health officers, and injection safety. 99% of the community-based vaccinator disposed Unigect in safety boxes. So this was really quite well done. Trying just to compare very quickly some of the percentages, the coverage for tetanus first dose, second dose was higher in the Unigect area compared to the non-Unigect area, and the dropout was lower in the Unigect area compared to the non-Unigect area. So in general, we suggest that this was really very nicely done in remote area and villages with limited logistics and limited trained personnel and special action. So, and then full dose was also done. There are a few challenges. Just let me share one challenge with them. The main challenge was that people, the community, was considering Unigect, the way that it was presented, as a contraception, as a contraceptive injection. So then ladies were not happy. Some groups, some anti-vaccine groups, were not happy. So we have to do a lot of sensitization. So we believe that this will be something possible in the future. And we think that if we synergize this with a supportive supervision system that we use with MVNA experience, this could be something really that we could do in the future in the developing world. I would like to thank different communities, the Minister of Health of Mali, the EPI of Mali, USAID Basics, and EPI partners, MSF, DNDI, and MSSM. Again, thank you very much. So I think we'll discuss the rest of the questions.
So that was an example of using a novel technology to extend services to groups that didn't normally have easy access, in this case to tetanus toxoid. So we're going to hear from Rebecca Gray now, who's the who's at Epicenter, and she's going to be telling us about.
Good morning. Yeah, can you? So this morning I was asked to talk about vaccination in crises. And before doing that, I just want to make a small reminder of the magnitude that we're talking about, which is sometimes forgotten. So what you see here is that each year there are about 9 million refugees. Now there are 26 million IDPs, about 1 million people that live in 40 so-called designated fragile states. And every year there are about 400 country-level national disasters that affect about 300 million people. But in addition to these populations in crises, which are called populations in crises, there's whole groups of populations which are vulnerable, which share the same characteristics as those populations living in crises, where there's insufficient vaccination coverage, poor surveillance, limited access to care, high birth rates, and the same difficulties. What we've heard a lot recently in the panel yesterday and today is all of these new initiatives. And what we know is that fortunately here, in no time other in history, have we had more possibilities to intervene with vaccines in crises. We have seen a flourishing of debate. We've seen the emergence of Gavi and all sorts of other potentially very good things that have moved the field forward. But at the same time, we also have, to some degree, in terms of recent reviews and what we see, is a failure to deliver. The reason for those failures to deliver, or accounting for them, is problematic. This is a difficult problem. And now this morning, I'll just talk through four of the main key reasons that we have a scenario where we're often left with muddling through in emergencies. We often fall back on the safest decision given the information of what we know. We may fail to consider hidden aspects of the problem and have difficulties in delivering vaccines to those that need it most. And so the first one, and I'll use an example of a vaccine for each one, is something very simple, which is we often don't have a lot of data about burden of disease and effectiveness of interventions. So in 2005, and again later in the Horn of Africa crisis, NGOs, donors, and governments briefly, and I say briefly because it was taken off the table, considered using the rotavirus vaccine in these two populations. We have infrequent access to the population at best, an extremely weak, if existent, public health infrastructure, and there isn't data on the burden of disease in rotavirus in these populations. Although granted, and to be fair, we could extrapolate from what we know elsewhere. In addition to that, we also have relatively sparse data on effectiveness of the intervention. What you see on this table are the key results of the trials for Rotarix and Rotatec, which are the two currently pre-qualified vaccines for rotavirus. What you should see on this table is the wide range of vaccine efficacy, which is presented here, and you can see that in the confidence intervals. And then down below, if we look at Mali, which Samba just talked about, it's even lower than one would expect. The reasons for these the low efficacy and the wide range of this aren't unexpected in an oral vaccine used in populations like this. But what makes it more troubling is there's even more complexity added to this. And those complexities concern actually delivering the vaccine effectively. What you see here in this figure is the narrow window that we have for optimal vaccination for a vaccine like rotavirus, which affects mainly children under the age of 6 months in the countries where we work. Although in the future we'll probably learn more, and there's certainly reason to be optimistic about the immune profiles of these populations and also the epidemiology of rotavirus itself, at the moment we're left with a scenario where we mainly muddle through in terms of the possible use of rotavirus in vulnerable populations. The second big problem which aggravates this scenario is we have limited presentation, formulation, and storage of available vaccines. And Dr. Seinglass talked a little bit about this, but one of the big constraints, and just for the sake of time, I'll talk only about the cold chain, which you all know was designed to ensure quality and also simplicity by following a single set of rules. But the infrastructure isn't always accessible, the demands are increasing, and this also limits our flexibility in reaching vulnerable populations. It's also important to note that during emergencies, when we do vaccination interventions, NGOs like MSF, we often mount the cold chain in parallel, which is a somewhat absurd situation in and of itself. But using the controlled temperature cold chain, where vaccines are kept in the cold chain all the way until they reach the end in the distribution process, could be a big advantage. But here again, we have a lack of information and ability to do so. What I'll show you now is just the preliminary results of a study that we're currently doing in Chad. And here, what you have, and the only thing really to take away from this slide, is that it's extremely hot in Chad. And you can see that in terms of the maximum ambient temperature. But what you see here are what vaccines are subjected to when they're exposed for 10 days, 20 days, and 30 days. And on the bottom is where the VVM reached. But this is all great, but we also want to make sure that the vaccines themselves are stable, and then, of course, we want to make sure that they're immunogenic afterwards. So here, in terms of stability, what we see with tetanus, which is a core vaccine, is it's very stable. And here what you see are vaccines which are exposed to 30 days outside of the cold chain, and you see that their potency, which is in the fourth column, is the same as vaccines which are left in the cold chain. And this is an extremely important piece of information which can then be used to ensure that flexible strategies are possible. The reason that flexible strategies are needed is also to ensure that we entertain and look at all of the possible panels of interventions in emergencies instead of simply reverting to a scenario where we have to mount the cold chain in parallel. The third thing I'd like to talk about in terms of the muddle through is, of course, politics. And you can't ignore this. This is absolutely, possibly one of the most important considerations. And here I'll talk about the use of the oral cholera vaccine. So there's been extreme difficulty in using the oral cholera vaccine in response to epidemics, despite the fact that in the past several years we've seen very large epidemics, such as those in Haiti and Zimbabwe, where they actually weren't used in response to those epidemics. There's a clear and real political hesitancy to declare cholera epidemics, and this is non-negligible in terms of the decision-making process. The use of these vaccines has and continues to be debated between NGOs, donors, and governments. There's only been scattered use of them in response to epidemics, and there's many a priori's and opinions that people have about their potential benefits, including the timing, the effectiveness, the potential diversion of resources, and concerns about the use of a two-dose vaccine in an epidemic. And on top of that, we have semi-vague WHO guidance, which currently states that they should be used where appropriate. What that exactly means is, of course, subject to interpretation. What you see on this slide is the recent use by MSF Switzerland of the oral cholera vaccine Shangkol in Guinea. And this was the first use of Shangkol in Africa in response to an epidemic. What you see here is just a lot of bars showing the vaccination coverage for one dose and two doses in different age ranges. But what you should just take away from here is that in terms of two-dose coverage, we achieved a coverage of 76%, and 93% of the population that was targeted received one dose. By doing interventions like this, it helps us to establish an evidence base, and it helps us center the conversation around something concrete instead of simply who shouts the loudest. And so we need to encourage interventions like this in order to help inform evidence-based policymaking. The final thing that I'd like to talk about is something which is somewhat difficult, and Samba touched on this earlier, about the importance of including many people in the discussion. But in terms of decision-making guidance, there's actually very little decision-making guidance in terms of how to use vaccines in crises, which vaccines, which antigens, what risk is presented to this population, and how to do all of this. And what happens in reality is that this prevents us from doing what should be done, and we revert to what we know how to do or what is available. The other consequence is that for people advocating for the right amount of aid at the right time, by focusing the arguments and the discussion on scientifically sound reasoning, helps dismiss the scope for dismissing the evidence entirely. The WHO recently convened a working group to attempt to address this gap, and I hope that this is a step in the right direction for providing a framework with which to base decisions on. The last thing I'd just like to mention is in terms of those four aspects, in terms of muddling through in vaccination and crises, is how to deal with those four things. The first is by funding and supporting sound documentation of burden of disease. It sounds basic, but it's non-negligible. The second, in terms of the vaccines and what we've been discussing here, is by ensuring that we engage in the discussion and that we contribute to the discussion prior to licensure of vaccines and pre-qualification. At that point in time, it's often too late to make different changes. The third thing is that I would hope when we have sound data and documentation of effective high coverage interventions, we can work a little bit towards minimizing certain political considerations. And the fourth thing is, of course, to recognize that populations that need these interventions the most are very rarely consulted, and neither are those whom deliver them. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. And I want to have you keep in mind one of the points, many of the points that she made, but one in particular, how to intervene earlier with manufacturers to influence them on producing the kinds of vaccines that are well adapted to the situation in low-income countries. So I'm planning to turn now to the discussants. I'll hope to go to each discussant a couple of times. And would ask that they keep their responses brief. Fred, what vaccine product characteristics are important to, in your case, Kenya, in the decision whether or not to introduce a specific vaccine product?
Thanks. I know I've got limited time, but I must be given a minute to thank you and the MSF for inviting me here. And to also thank you for inviting 4 out of 440 million I'm the fourth Kenyan to speak on this podium from a small population. Coming to the precise question, I think two issues are particularly pertinent. One is cold storage capacity. And historically, that's really what has put us down from time to time. A vaccine preparation should allow us to use the minimum storage capacity within the infrastructure of the country, because that's what takes the biggest beating. And number two, the heat stability. Kenya has a diverse environment, actually. We have Nairobi, where I live, with the temperature that can approach what is in New York today, and then the outskirts, which goes has a temperature of 50. And therefore, those are two points that we hold dear for vaccine preparation.
Thank you very much, Fred. Nina Schwabe, a question about, as Gavi is a major purchaser of vaccines, so how does Gavi learn, in fact, about country preferences regarding the preferred vaccine products? And how can that process be even more strengthened so that Gavi, for example, sends clear signals to industry as to what is required?
Thanks, Robert, for the question, and thanks also to the organizers for inviting Gavi to be here with you today. I think that Gavi, in its first 10 years, was thinking really about how to get the current vaccines out, and a little bit less. There was an assumption that sort of Keynesian economics would work. Not quite sure why they had that assumption, but and supply and demand would lead to competition, and we get the right products eventually that people want. And I think in our first 10 years, we realized that we were getting the vaccines out, but we weren't doing a particularly good job on sort of influencing the market. So in the second decade, Gavi adopted a specific market shaping agenda about balancing supply and demand, minimizing costs to Gavi and countries, and ensuring appropriate quality of vaccines while fostering innovation. When we talk about cost also, too, there was a recognition that it's not just about the cost of the vaccine, but it's also about the cost of delivering that vaccine within the system. And that has to do with size of, cold chain requirements, number of visits, and all the systems-related issues that go with it. So right now, we really are trying to think far in advance. One of the things that Gavi does is, I'm a bit of a Marxist and believe in the dialectic, and one of the great things about our board is that we have civil society and industry, and we sit them together in a room so that they can talk. And we also have, most importantly, the countries and ministers of health from the countries themselves also at the table to be able to debate and dialogue. So I think sort of moving forward, there are a number of things that we realize need to happen to make products more adaptable. We're about to start in January an extensive process to set what are the next set of vaccines that we want to take on. And that will start with consultation with countries. And then in terms of the products that we are already producing, we are encouraging discussions with manufacturers to bring them to the countries and see actually what's happening. And it was interesting, I was talking recently to one of the manufacturers of the rotavirus vaccines, and who said quite frankly and honestly, when we were developing this vaccine in 1990 and our product developers were working on it, there was no Gavi and we really didn't think about it. So the characteristics of that vaccine that they developed, we weren't thinking about Gavi markets. And they also said, frankly, we weren't thinking about price and whether the vaccine cost us $3 or $4 or $5 or $6 to make in terms of cost of goods. That wasn't on our radar because we were planning to sell it at 50, 60, 70, 80. So I think that's where we're getting engaged. We're working on second generation now HPV vaccine, second generation pneumococcal vaccine, some of the data coming out from MSF and others, second generation rotavirus vaccines. And so thinking first about the products that we have on hand, but then also about the needs of the future products.
Thank you, Nina. Back to you, Fred, for another response. How do you think the preferences for new products and technologies should be better brought to the attention of policymakers and funding agencies?
Let me catch your question again.
Yeah, how do you think the preferences for new products and technologies should be better brought to the attention of policymakers and funding agencies?
I think the vital thing is to persuade and convince the policymakers that these products are essential and useful, using whatever evidence available. Often they look for disease burden and that, to give what is. Then the next is to sort of convince them that these are going to embed into the existing program and probably not straining them so much more than they would if they're coming as vertical programs. And the third one, and I guess we still have to, at advocacy level, convince policymakers that there will always be a cost at something good. It can't be free, so often you can't introduce it and pay no extra money. But the best way to convince them is that we prepare ourselves to disrupt very little of the existing program in terms of the timing and the scheduling, and basically provide prior preparation of the health workers in the field. And by the time we are discussing with them, we are ready and telling them that at an extra cost, not much disruption of what's existing, we are ready to introduce this new vaccine and this other new vaccine.
I think this issue about a feedback loop is really important. From my perspective, it's been missing for a very long time. Perfect example is measles. Here we're tending to talk about the new vaccines, but even the old vaccines. If you go to many countries, you find that health workers are reluctant to open up a 10-dose measles vaccine for fear of wastage, for fear of finishing their month's stock before the end of the month and being blamed. So measles in a 5-dose vial, because it has to be thrown out at the end of the day, is much more likely to lead to higher coverage and higher timely coverage. And there are data now beginning to emerge, which hopefully will make that case. So we even have old issues that we still have to deal with, and not just the new ones. I'd like to turn to Mark now. Mark, you've done amazing work on meningitis in Africa, which was a neglected disease for so long. I wonder if you would contrast and briefly explain how you went about developing the MenAfriVac vaccine in record time, which was a model that was quite different from previous models and at an affordable price as well. And do you see that model as a one-off anomaly, or in fact, does that model teach anything about producing other vaccines?
Hopefully, the model stands as an example of what can be done using a different approach. The approach that was used was one that was founded in working in Africa. Samba remembers the first trips back in 2001, where the project simply wanted to establish what the desires were and what were the realities at the country level in terms of already cold chain space, what would be acceptable, what would work, what wouldn't work. And so I would say that one of the major reasons that this all worked was that there was a consultation at the country level that really served as the floor for the development that worked. And once these relationships were established, and to establish a relationship, it's like dating somebody to get married. It takes years usually, and so it takes a long time, but when you do that, you learn your foibles, what you do wrong and what you did wrong, and you start really developing what I call a true negotiation, which really works to respect the initiatives and the realities that are on the countryside, as well as the sort of stuff that you have to work with in terms of meeting regulatory requirements and all of that stuff. So I would say that that story is largely one that's founded on relationships and the information that was synthesized from those relationships.
And has salience for the development of other vaccines as well.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
I mean, why do we not have a conjugate typhoid vaccine?
Right. Actually, staying with you, Mark, and Paul as well, the same question. MenAfriVac has also recently become a pathfinder of sorts in terms of being able to gain regulatory approval to be used, what's popularly known as out of the cold chain, but is really a controlled temperature chain for up to 4 days at up to 104 degrees. So I wonder, both Mark and Paul, what would it take to get other vaccines that are currently under development to be licensed for that kind of on-label use at broader temperatures right from the start?
I would like to start by again, just sort of saying that That was possible because of this dialogue that was right at the very beginning, and actually going and knowing the countries and actually being in the field. It becomes very apparent that it's 115 degrees on a cool day. And so part of the discussions was, were always, gee whiz, if you really also pay attention in terms of thermal stability of the vaccine instead of just 2 to 8 degrees, this would really be very, very helpful. And so with a consultation with actually a French company, Ariel, Ariel actually came and worked with MVP for, oh, it would have been at least 6 months, 6 to 9 months, and the changes that were made in terms of stabilizing that particular vaccine product turned out to be superb decisions, because when tested in the field, that vaccine now can essentially be pulled out of the cold chain, and you can go to the furthest village first, which is always, I think, one of the most important things, particularly if you're talking about something like meningitis.
So important implications. You know, everyone is talking about equity and reaching the unreached. So having the right products will, in fact, make that easier to do. Paul, any response as well?
Yes, absolutely. I think that is exactly one of the key points that we're trying to address. Just one very quick example. In diarrhea, you just talked about typhoid. There was a proof of concept vaccine available, which was using the VI antigen. The issue was that this proof of concept vaccine was not available to the mass of patients. Simply, just to illustrate to people, VI is extracted out of Salmonella typhi. Salmonella typhi is a so-called biosafety level 3 organism, which needs to be handled very carefully. Now, if you extract this antigen, you have to have, you know, like 10,000 liter fermenters where you grow the bacteria to then take the protein out. Now, if everybody has ever seen a 10,000 liter fermenter in a BSL-3 facility, let me know. It would cost horrendous amount of money. Second, the solvent you need to extract this antigen is one of the most feared environmental poisons and is being banned as we speak. Third, you talked about conjugation. It was not conjugated, and it's probably not enough immunogenic for the infants that are need them. So what Rino Rapoli and Alan Saul, who work at our institute in Siena, did, they said, let's ignore all the people who don't believe in evolution. And let's go with the science that says that many organisms have common ancestors. And they did something that is possible only recently because of Craig Venter's work and other sequencers. They say, well, if there is a common ancestor, maybe there is another bacteria that makes VI that is less dangerous. And they went through the databases and looked at all of those, and they found one, Citrobacter. And in fact, Citrobacter is not toxic, and it can be grown in a normal fermenter without all of the BSL-3. Solves problem one. Second, they called people that are unsung, which are the chemical engineers, and say, find us another extraction method without this poison. They did that. And the third one, they conjugated the VI that extracted from Citrobacter with another amplifying protein, CRM. And now this is in phase 2-3. And we hope with this that we can transform a proof of concept of something was useless to the scientifically interesting but useless to patient to a vaccine that will be able to roll out. That is being tested in Pakistan as we speak. And we're talking to also to the colleagues at IVI to combine forces to get this done more quickly. Just a quick example of what are the kinds of things that you can do.
Right. Staying with you, Paul, for a moment, and more broadly, do you think industry would generally be agreeable to systematically share with, for example, WHO, their heat stability data across a wider range of temperatures than is required to meet regulatory requirements in the first world?
Let me talk about the institutes that I was closely involved with, for instance, the one in Siena. There is no question that all the data we have is available to everybody. On the commercial sides, we need to discuss, but I know Rino Rapoli is very open to these kinds of things.
Right. Good, thank you. Going back to you, Nina, how can Gavi better use its purchasing power to drive prices down and get products that are better adapted to country needs. What help might you need, for example, from civil society? You mentioned civil society earlier is on the board, but what help might you need from civil society to help, in fact, achieve that, to get the prices down and products better adapted?
I think there's two different issues. One is prices down, which is about the here and now, and saying that, I mean, this meeting is about access, and I was very left with great impression by the MDR, the fact that we still only have 20,000 people on treatment, even though there are 500,000 people we know and probably 1 million people who are ill with the disease. So I think the first issue that Gavi has is to take the tools we have available to save kids' lives now and get those out as quickly as possible. And in that way, we're really changing the way we're doing business. I'm also sorry UNICEF Supply Division isn't here, because we've been working quite innovatively with them to sort of think about long-term purchasing commitments, longer-term guarantees, so some different way, multi-round tendering, which for UN agencies is actually quite a different way of doing business. So thinking about innovative ways to tender to bring the prices down. And as you know, we've secured the rotavirus vaccine from GSK as an example at $2.50 per dose, which was even the lowest public price before that was 15, and then the markets in US and elsewhere are considerably higher. So there's that about what we do now with the current vaccines. And then there's the future vaccines, and I think that's quite a complicated process, but one that we're extremely focused on. So there's been a lot of talk about IP in vaccines, and the common lore is actually it's about technical know-how. IP really isn't that important. We actually are beginning not to believe that and are looking at how we can explore more, and Gavi can do more on the area to look at the way that IP actually does affect the production of second-generation vaccines. Tech transfer is also something that people are looking at in terms of looking at ways to drive innovation and get down prices. And there was some mention earlier of the Eli Lilly and MDR-TB, and I think that's an example I'd like to touch base with colleagues from this conference to learn. It seems like something didn't go right quite there with that process, and I'd like to explore that a little bit kind of across the panels that you've put together. I think the other thing is with the push funding, I think that Mark's program was incredibly successful, and that MenA, and as many of you may know, that's just the first step, because MenA is one of the killer strains, but there's also CY and W, which are also critically important that we need to be moving on. So I understand Serum has a second generation moving, but the point with that I wanted to make was around the access pricing. Funders like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, when they invest in product development partnerships, part of the deal for the PDPs and others, and when they work directly with industry, is access pricing, and that becomes incredibly important. And I would also like to see a little bit more transparency around what are those access agreements, what do they mean, what do they commit us to. So I think that's another area. And the final area that I think we need to work on, and I was glad to see Marie Polkini here for part of the morning, is on the pre-qualification and regulatory strengthening. These are also areas that Gavi's just taken on what was quite a controversial decision at our last board meeting, which was to say that actually products that Gavi purchases or funds don't actually require WHO pre-qualification. What they require instead is that the producing country is considered has a functioning regulatory authority, and the buying country has a functioning regulatory authority. So these are all ways that we think we can speed the path.
Back to you, Paul. Thank you, Nina. But I was going to ask this of Mark, but I think Mark's already answered it. But I'll ask you, Paul. How should industry seek inputs to guide development of vaccine products that are suitable for use in lower-income countries? How do you do it, and how do you see it being done maybe better in the future?
Well, one way is taking part in these conferences mm-hmm. and listening to what the people from the field say. That's what we do very intensively. And we organize scientific meetings with experts in this to listen exactly about these things. I think in science, that's the best way. Listen to the people who know about it. And mm-hmm. we'll continue to do that.
Well, very concretely, something that has puzzled me is how much lead time does industry require not to develop vaccines from the outset, but actually to simply adapt those vaccines that are under development such that, for example, they're in presentations and packaging that is more suitable for use in lower-income countries?
This is extremely variable, because that's science. You know, how long would it have taken to find the Citrobacter? It could have been quick, or it was quick. It could have been much longer.
Right. But I'm referring to just the what I think is the end stage of figuring out how many doses to put in that vial and the actual size of the vial and the size of the packaging, because that's oftentimes a limiting factor in developing countries.
Well, that can be relatively quick, and I think in the case of this vaccine, Salmonella Tifi vaccine, it seems to be happening very short time from the start to being now in testing in Pakistan. So it was only like 2-3 years.
Right. So, I mean, to me, a take-home message is that it's really important to have an open conversation as early as possible between practitioners who are concerned about public health in developing countries and the manufacturers, because there could be late-stage decisions made by vaccine producers that needn't go in that direction, but could in fact go in a direction more amenable to use in the developing world. Last questions for Mark and Paul. Does the future of vaccine development, in your estimation, include more partnerships between developed world and developing world manufacturers? And what benefit would that have for public health? Mark and Paul both.
Yeah, I think that's a tremendous avenue over the next decade. Many developing country vaccine manufacturers, their infrastructures have gotten better and better and better and better over the last 10 to 20 years. And that was one of the big surprises that I learned when I first started, is because my initial visits to some of the Indian vaccine manufacturers was really in the mid-1970s. And so I hadn't been back until 1991, and I thought I was at Merck. The changes have really been dramatic, and particularly in terms of their capacity. They have really very large capacity. Pharma, or the major internationals, had a tremendous amount of knowledge and a tremendous scientific capacity. And it would be nice to see these things actually work and get linked more closely together in terms of being able to transfer this ability to make vaccines in volume, because that's really where the savings are. The savings occur. Vaccines, once you're making above 50 million doses of a vaccine a year, are cheap, period. There are some tendencies that I like to think are really opportunities that offer a lot of promise, particularly for large-scale production of vaccines that are needed. I'd be interested.
I can make it very short. I fully agree with you, and in fact, the manufacturing partner for the Tifi will be an Indian manufacturer, because we found exactly the same evolution, and I was extremely happy yesterday to hear Caro's example of initiatives like that happening in Africa. We would very much like to do it there too, as soon as the partners are available.
Thank you. I'd like to turn now just for very brief comments from Rachel and Dr. So, based upon what they've heard from the discussants, in case there's anything they'd like to add to the discussion. Dr. So.
Okay, thank you very much. I really think that we should continue to believe on the success, but just wanted to echo a few ideas from yourself and from the discussants. Whatever evolutions or innovation we wanted to bring into the developing world in terms of vaccine and vaccine-preventable diseases, we will really need to work in very close collaboration with the people on ground. So you cannot take any new idea or devices or vaccines without actually involving the country people, and without involving using local data produced by local people. So that's my very, you know, very important point for me to share. And second, I would strongly recommend before using any new device or any new, like for example, vaccine resistant to temperature, we want, just let's be very careful. We are taking this out and say this is okay, and then somebody will then boil the vaccine and vaccinate somebody with that. I mean, we have to really be very careful and take things easy and go step by step instead of going so quickly in this part of the world, because there are other groups also working along with us. They are telling us, so I would like to mention here, you know, the traditional healers. So they use modern medicine, but they use it, you know, traditionally. So actually, some of their medicine could be like a bomb. So we have to be careful and involve not only decision makers, not only politicians, not only peripheral and local doctors, but all traditional and cultural groups working along with us must be involved in this process.
Right. Thank you. The importance of assuring quality. I mean, vaccines are not. It's not like treatment where people are prepared to maybe take some risk to be cured. This is something that the government and wants everyone to take, and it has to be absolutely safe. Otherwise, the entire program is at great risk. And Rebecca?
Yeah, I was going to echo the same thing. So we talked a bit about presentation and reformulation and adaptation of the vaccines, which is all very important. And of course, we want to advocate for that. But we also, I just don't want to forget that we actually want these vaccines to work. there's not a great benefit to having a vaccine which is adapted but totally inappropriate to the local epidemiology or the diseases which are faced by that population. And so just to bring a little bit back, a little more medicine back into this conversation, I think the most effective way to deliver vaccines and have there be uptake by the populations that most need them is by delivering a highly effective intervention.
Great, thank you. And so just in conclusion, just a few comments. I think we do have to capture and accelerate and apply field learning. That's come out very clearly from most of the panelists and discussants regarding the kind of vaccine products that are most appropriate for use in the developing world. Frankly, there's been an absence of that kind of feedback loop for a very long time, and I'm encouraged to know that things have started to improve with greater recognition of how important that is. We heard about the importance of starting from the field understanding those needs backed up by good local data. And just to leave you with one quote from John Le Carre, he said, "A desk is a dangerous place from which to view the world." So very important to go out there and find out what countries actually require, make sure that information is acted upon by the funding agencies and early enough by the manufacturers to in fact make sure that their products are going to be maximally useful and safe and effective. So I just want to thank all of the speakers and panelists.